Okay, so people, email, how does it work? Nido will talk about it, so please give it up for Nido.
All right, test on 2, 3. All right, I'm going to talk a bit about email, how it works. Basically, I want to give you enough information so you have a bit of a feeling of how the protocols work, so you can continue on it yourself. First, what is email? In my opinion, there are basically three important parts of an email, which is it's something that is sent, some sort of message format, as in I send you an email. You can check your email, download it from some server somewhere, somehow, and you can also send it, I send you an email. Also, if you're a business user who's in a suit, then usually when you say email, you also mean an exchange server, but that's not the subject we're going to be talking about. All right, we're going to talk a bit about the different message formats there are for email, ways of receiving and ways of sending. First, the message formats. What you call an email is usually formatted in the internet message format, which is first defined as the RFC 822 and then superseded by the other two. It's a very simple protocol, but it's not yet complete. Usually your email also is formatted in RFC 2046, multi-purpose internet mail extensions. And you may have guessed, yes, that's the mine you've all been hearing about. All right, first the internet message format. It's basically in US ASCII. You can use at most 998 characters on a line, and it's terminated by character return line feeds. In other words, basically the same thing that Notepad can do. It starts first with a bunch of headers, then it's followed by an empty line, and then it's followed by the body text. Headers are separated by a header name, followed by a colon, followed by the header content. Header name, in this case, is case insensitive. Header content is not. If you have a header which is longer than 1,000 characters, it will not fit in the email format, so they have a special way to extend it. If the next line of a header starts with a space, then it's basically a continuation of the previous header. This is called in the RFC folding. And also, if you have a custom header which is not defined in the RFCs, you should start it with an X. However, it should, so there are lots of headers in your mails which do not follow that recommendation. Problem with this up to now is that we're talking about US ASCII text, and when is the last time you've seen an email which was actually plain text? And the other one is you usually see emails with attachments, and within this specification there's no room for it, so there was some extension to it which was MIME. MIME allows us to make multi-part messages, so for example an email with an attachment, and it allows you to send email in different formats than standard US ASCII using the MIME types. So like content type, text, HTML, probably somewhere in your HTTP requests. This is an example of a MIME multi-part message. In MIME, you define a header of the type content type, and that is multipart slash mixed. There are other ways, but usually it's multipart mixed. And then you define a boundary, and that can be basically any text you want. In this case, I've chosen to use Pony. After that header, there's a bunch of text where you can type it. If your client does not understand MIME, this is a MIME message, so I'm sorry. Until there is a dash dash and then the boundary you defined earlier. And after that, the first part of the multipart message begins. It defines the content type as per the definition earlier. So in this case, I have a message which is content type text plain, and the message itself is message part 1.
If you do not define the content type on this part, then it will be automatically assumed that it is a text/plain kind of document. I've also included in this message the second part, which is of the content type application octet stream, which basically means a bunch of bytes. And in this case, I also added a content transfer encoding, because, well, if you want to send arbitrary bytes, well, arbitrary bytes are not defined in the US ASCII, so you need a way to encode it so it actually fits in the US ASCII. In this case, it's used Base64, and then there's a Base64 encoded message, which if you decode it, happens to say hello. Don't forget to end your last part of your message with also another boundary, or else it will probably not be received. Or received read. Alright, now we're going on to reading email. There are two protocols for this. One is the post office protocol, RFC number is there, and the other one is the Internet Message Access Protocol, or IMAP. To start off with the post office protocol, it works by way of the style of a mail drop. That is to say, people send email to your internet service provider. They hold the mail there for some time until you connect using post office protocol. Then you basically download all the mail that is there, and then the mail is not at the ISP anymore, but you have it on your own servers. It's also US ASCII communications, and it basically works like you give a command and you give arguments. Pretty simple, and yes, this means you can talk with this using telnet. There are a bunch of commands you can give. Well, most, I guess, you can guess what it means. User pass, quit, delete, retin is retrieve. There, this one we use to download lists to see how much emails are there, etc., etc. Look in the RFC to see what exactly everything does. For an example, communication, client can send a command list, and the server will answer, okay, there are two messages, and that's a total of 320 octets. In this example, the first message was 120 octets, and the second message was 200 octets. And that's the end of the list. You can also send a command with an argument, so list 2, then it will list mail number 2, which is the one with the 200 octets of data. On to IMAP. IMAP works a bit different. It works more like a mailbox. So when you connect to it, you have in your account, you have different mailboxes, inbox, outbox, etc. And the mails will be when it will stay on the mail server. Once you download it, it is still there. This is also US ASCII communications. So yes, you can also talk with this with Telnet. And it has a feature which allows to do command multiplexing. So you can send multiple commands while it is still working on the first. The way you send the command to IMAP is by first you define a tag. You can basically make it any text you like. You can define it yourself
so you can find it back later. Then you give the actual command followed by any arguments you want to give it. So in this case, I used the tag ABCD, and I used the command capability, and the server will reply to me what its capabilities are. And then it tells me that the command is completed. You can do several commands also with IMAP. Select is in order to select either your inbox, outbox, send mail, spam, etc. List tells you what are the mails which are in this particular mailbox. Fetch allows you to download the mail, or only headers, or different things depending on what kind of arguments you give. Store allows you to actually save stuff on it using the IMAP protocol. And yes, you can also use it then for other purposes. There's somebody who actually made a fuse module to allow you to store actual files on the IMAP server. Delete, you can guess. Now to the final one, a simple mail transfer protocol. Most people don't really find it simple, but it is pretty simple actually if you know what it actually does. It has two parts. It tells me how I am able to find your mail server, And apart from that, it also tells you how to actually send mail. So first, where to send, how to find to where to send mail. It uses an MX record from your DNS server, and it wants tries to do the lowest preference MX record first, then can try higher preference services, or if there's no MX record available, it implicitly will use the A record for the domain. The MX records are first letters MX, followed by a preference number, followed by the host name of the machine which will actually be receiving the email. So once you've done that and you find out where you actually need to send the mail to, you can connect to that using SMTP on port 25. But this is an example MX record, I'm sorry. And SMTP also pretty simple. You basically give some commandos with arguments. And there's also one special type of command you can give, which is data, after which you can basically give it any data you want, or any data you want to have in the email, followed by a new line, followed by a followed by a period, followed by a new line. That's the way to end the data stream. Now, if you want to send an actual period in this message itself, you need to prepend it with another period. If you want to send two periods, you also need to prepend it with another period. So if your line start is only a number of periods, you need to add one in order to get it through through the commands. Okay, so now example communication with a mail server. The first thing you do when you send a command to an SMTP server is to say hello, followed by what's your host name. Well, that's what you're supposed to do. Most mail servers will accept any text you put there. And there have also been cases where what you put there is what the mail server will believe is actually the host name of the server. So in that case, you can send them hello localhost. And then the mail server believes that you are localhost. And localhost is allowed to send mail to anywhere. So you, as localhost, are able to send mail to anywhere. Make sure you don't configure your mail server like that. Anyway, the email server will respond with the command 250 and then its own host name. By the way, the 250 is a status code. You're going to recognize this if you're familiar with the HTTP. 200 numbers are success, 400 numbers are failures, 500 numbers are temporary failures, try again later. So you've sent a hello, then you need to tell mail from. In this case, I'm sending it mail from an address which is cracker@evil.ru. In case you're wondering, no, I do not own evil.ru. I do not have any rights to use this email address. However, your mail server will not know that and will just accept it. So then, after I've said it where I send him the mail from, I need to tell him where the where I want to send the mail to. The command for that is rcpt2, followed by the email address of the person in question you want to send the mail to. And then it will also respond with the 250, or in case it has some detection to see if you're fucking around, then it may give you a failure. After this comes the data command. And then it tells you to start entering data, followed by an enter.enter. So now we're at the point where we can send it the actual email. And I don't think if you receive from me an email from cracker@evil.ru that you're going to open it. So in the email itself, I will tell you that it's from Cyberonderzoeksraad, cyber@cyberonderzoeksraad.nl. I can tell it still that I'm sending it to you. And I give it an extra new line in order to tell it that this is the end of the headers. And then I can send you the spam, followed by a period to tell it that it's the end of the email. And usually your mail server will happily accept it from me and send it into your mailbox. There are a few things we can do in order to stop these problems. One of them is the sender policy framework. This is something which is actually used by Cyberonderzoeksraad, which is why I didn't use it as the real email address to send it from. The sender policy framework is basically a list of mail servers which are allowed to send mail from a certain domain. There are two types of records in which you can put it. One of them is the actual SPF record, which is basically designed for this, and the other one is the text record, because by the time this was designed, people didn't want to add extra types of DNS records into their DNS interfaces. But text was already there, so you can probably send in a text record. You basically start with telling it that this is a SPF 1 version, this version SPF 1, and then followed by a list of hosts which are allowed to send email. You can tell it, for example, that with MX, you tell it that all the incoming mail servers are also allowed to send email on behalf of this domain. You can use A, followed by a colon, followed by the A record, in order to let it forward A records, well, IPv4 addresses, IPv6 addresses. You can also include other SPF domains, which is handy if you have taken the services of some bulk mailer to send a lot of mail on your behalf. You can just include their SPF records, and then all their mail servers should also be allowed to send mail on your behalf. There's also the CNAME. Well, if you know how the DNS works, then you can probably guess how that's it. And at the end, you can either say minus all, which means everything not in this list is not allowed to send email, or tilde all, which I lost the tilde in compiling this document, so pretend it is actually there. And tilde all basically means other mail servers might send email from my domain. So the best thing is to say minus all, so you actually say, no, if it's not from me, then it's not a mail which is legitimate. Otherwise, people can still use your domain to send email. Example of an SPF record. Basically, in this case, the MX records are allowed to send email. DirectVPS2.nidomedia is allowed to send email, and this specific IPv6 address, and nothing else. Other than that, there's also DKIM, or Domain Key Identified Mail. This works with a public and private key pair. You have on your mail server or on your own system, you have a private key, and somewhere in your DNS records you publish the public key. And another mail server is then able to take that and to check whether or not the email is legitimate. How, by the way, of a DKIM signature, such as this example, A tells it how what kind of algorithm it needs to use in order to calculate the hash. D is the domain name. S is a selector, which is basically something you can choose yourself. And depending on which selector you've created, you need to have a corresponding DNS record. C is the type of signature you want to do, because headers can be rearranged by your mail server. So maybe somewhere along the way, the mail get mangled. So if we basically take a hash of the message itself as it was received, it's not going to go over anyway. There are two ways to do this. One is called simple, which is basically carbon copy whatever the headers are in the order as which they are defined, then hash that. And relax, which also removes white spaces, folds the headers, etc., in order to make some canonical form, so your mail server will always be able to find the correct way to do it. T in this case is a timestamp of when this signature was created. X is the time when this particular key pair will expire. These are basically Unix timestamps. H in this case defines the type of headers which you want to do the signature over. You can select any ones you like to use. Sometimes, for example, you do not want to add 2 to your list because you want to prepare an email beforehand and then later send it out to whoever you want to send it to. All right, Z is a combination of all the headers you have copied from the other headers for the use of the signature. You can compare this with the actual headers to see if they are still the same. BH is a hash of the header body, of the body text, and B is the actual signature of the entire text itself. This is of course still not completely safe, because as I said, you can select whichever headers you will encrypt. So if I have access to your mail server at some moment, I can create a signature with no headers, and then at least that part has already been compromised. Also, there's a way to say which length of the body you want to actually sign. Because sometimes at some companies there are mail servers which also append another piece of text at the end of your email. And well, if you don't have that part of the email, then you can sign that. So you can tell, no, only sign the first so many bytes. If I sign the first 0 bytes, then I can use that signature to basically send any mail I want with your signature on it. And basically that's it. So if there are any questions, I have a lot of time, I think.
Are there any questions? Yes, I'll come to you. I'll use this microphone. It's a little bit better.
How does DKIM verification work?
I'm sorry?
The domain verification. So when you send it from a certain address, that you can verify that this address is also...
DKIM is just the domain names. Under the underscore, somewhere in your DNS you publish your public key, mm-hmm. And when you send an email, you sign it and add the header with the hash and with the signature to your email. Okay. Your mail client can then take that signature, mm-hmm. Use the public key that's on the DNS, and check whether that is the correct signature. If it is okay, if it passes, then the mail is actually the mail that has been sent. If it fails, then there has been some change somewhere in the email, and it may not be correct. However, there are lots of mail servers which, if they find, hey, there is some DKIM signature header, then it's probably okay and good mail.
Any more? All right. Well, thank you, Nido, for this talk. This is the last talk for the day. So we'll close it up. There's a pub quiz in the main bar, which should be starting soon. And there's the whiskey tasting in the boardroom, so you're all free to join. So thank you very much for your attention, and we'll see you tomorrow.